Good morning. This morning, our liturgy begins a bit incongruously and not as printed in the bulletin because of the events of the past multiple weeks and the prevalence of continued gun violence in our country, and especially the victims who are the most innocent among us and the most vulnerable. And so, as we've been asked time and again, we will give our prayers, but as one tradition in Judaism says, if you pray without intention of acting, then you are in danger of committing a heresy. And so today, as we pray, let us be mobilized to action. And this morning, we'll be praying the litany provided for us by the leadership of not just our bishop, but the bishops against gun violence, who have created a litany that tries to be comprehensive, and yet in its staggering scope cannot indeed encompass all those who have died in our country as a result of mass shootings. And so there will be omissions, and you will be remembering them this morning, and you will hear those absences. It might seem also incongruous in this, the season of Easter, as we're on the cusp of summer and all the joy that it brings, to be entering in this morning in a spirit of both penitence and sorrow. And yet the season of Easter reminds us that God resurrected Jesus from the grave, and that even death does not have the last word. And so, it is entirely appropriate that we will be praying these words today in resurrection hope. The petition is simple. As I bid each time, give to the departed eternal rest, your response is, let light perpetual shine upon them. The last three petitions, you'll notice the change, will be just, hear us, Lord. And then there will be the bidding, Lord, have mercy. Let us pray. God of peace, we remember all those who have died in incidents of mass gun violence in this nation's public and private spaces. 5 dead at the Red Lake Senior High School in Red Lake, Minnesota. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 6 dead at the Wisconsin Sikh Temple. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 12 dead at an Aurora, Colorado movie theater. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 28 dead at Sandy Hook Elementary School in Newtown, Connecticut. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 6 dead at Santa Monica College, California. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 7 dead at Hialeah, Florida apartment complex. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 13 dead at the Washington Navy Yard. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 4 dead at Fort Hood, Texas. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 7 dead in Isla Vista near UC Santa Barbara. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 5 dead at Marysville Pilchuck High School in Washington. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 6 dead in Montgomery County, Pennsylvania. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 9 dead at Emmanuel AME in Charleston, South Carolina. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 16 dead at San Bernardino, California office. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 10 dead at Umpqua Community College, Oregon. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 6 dead in Kalamazoo, Michigan. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 4 dead at a Heston, Kansas office. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 5 dead at a Wilkinsburg, Pennsylvania backyard party. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 50 dead at Pulse Nightclub in Orlando, Florida. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 5 dead at Cascade Mall in Burlington, Washington. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 5 dead at Fort Lauderdale Airport. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 4 dead in Fresno, California. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 8 dead in Lincoln County, Mississippi. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 4 dead at an Eaton Township, Pennsylvania supermarket. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 9 dead at a Plano, Texas football watching party. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 59 dead at a Las Vegas, Nevada concert. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 27 dead at First Baptist Church in Sutherland Springs, Texas. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 17 dead at Marjorie Stoneman Douglas High School in Parkland, Florida. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 5 dead at the Veterans Home in Yountville, California. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 4 dead at a Nashville, Tennessee Waffle House. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 10 dead at a Santa Fe High School, Texas. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 5 dead at the Capital Gazette newspaper in Annapolis, Maryland. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 4 dead at the Fifth Third Center in Cincinnati, Ohio. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 4 dead at a Rite Aid distribution center in Aberdeen, Maryland. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 11 dead at the Tree of Life Synagogue in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 13 dead at a bar in Thousand Oaks, California. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 5 dead at a bank in Sebring, Florida. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 5 dead at their homes in Ascension and Livingston Parishes, Louisiana. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 6 dead at an industrial park in Aurora, Illinois. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 4 dead at a home in Clinton, Mississippi. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 4 dead in Ceylon Township, Michigan. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 13 dead at a municipal building in Virginia Beach, Virginia. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 4 dead at the Gilroy Garlic Festival in Gilroy, California. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 22 dead at a Walmart in El Paso, Texas. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 10 dead at the Oregon District of downtown Dayton, Ohio. Give to the department eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 8 dead on the road between the cities of Odessa and Midland, Texas. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 5 dead in their home in Elkmont, Alabama. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 4 dead at a bar in Kansas City, Kansas. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 4 dead at a backyard football watch party in Fresno, California. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 6 dead at a cemetery and kosher market in Jersey City, New Jersey. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 6 dead at the Molson Coors Complex in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 5 dead at a convenience store in Springfield, Missouri. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 5 dead in the northeast side of Indianapolis, Indiana. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 8 dead at 3 spas in Atlanta, Georgia. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 10 dead at a grocery store in Boulder, Colorado. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 4 dead at an office complex in Orange, California. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 6 dead at a home in Rock Hill, South Carolina. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 9 dead at a FedEx facility in Indianapolis, Indiana. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. 7 dead at a birthday party in Colorado Springs, Colorado. Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light
10 dead at a rail yard in San Jose, California. Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
4 dead at Oxford High School in Oxford Township, Michigan. Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
5 dead in Lakewood in Denver, Colorado. Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
5 dead at the church in Sacramento, California. Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
6 dead in downtown Sacramento, California. Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual
shine upon them. 10 dead at a supermarket in Buffalo, New York. Give to the departed eternal rest. 22 dead at Robb Elementary School in Uvalde, Texas. Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
All those who have died in any incident of gun violence, give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
For survivors of gun violence, grant them comfort and healing. Hear us, Lord. For those who have lost loved ones to gun violence, grant them peace. Hear us, Lord. For those first responders who care for victims of gun violence, protect and strengthen them. Hear us, Lord. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Thank you.
With broken hearts, let us declare in confidence the truth. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, the King of glory, you have exalted your only Son, Jesus Christ, with great triumph to your kingdom in heaven. Do not leave us comfortless, but send us your Holy Spirit to strengthen us and exalt us to that place where our Savior Christ has gone before, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God in glory everlasting.
Amen.
Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. With Paul and Silas, we came to Philippi in Macedonia, a Roman colony. And as we were going to the place of prayer, we met a slave girl who had a spirit of divination and brought her owners a great deal of money by fortune telling. While she followed Paul and us, she would cry out, "These men are slaves of the Most High God, who proclaim you to a way of salvation." She kept doing this for many days, but Paul, very much annoyed, turned and said to her, to the Spirit, "I order you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her," and it came out that very hour. But when her owners saw that their hope of making money was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace before the authorities. When they had brought them before the magistrates, they said, "These men are disturbing our cities. They are Jews and are advocating our customs that are not lawful for us as Romans to adopt or observe." The crowd joined in attacking them, and the magistrates had them stripped of their clothing and ordered them to be beaten with rods. After they had given them a severe flogging, they threw them into prison and ordered the jailer to keep them securely. Following these instructions, he put them in the innermost cell and fastened their feet to the stocks. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was an earthquake so violent that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's chains were unfastened. When the jailer woke up and saw the prison doors wide open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, since he supposed that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul shouted in a loud voice, "Do not harm yourself, for we are all here." The jailer called for lights, and rushing in, he fell down, trembling before Paul and Silas. Then he brought them outside and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" They answered, "Believe on the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household." They spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house. At the same hour of the night, he took them and washed their wounds. Then he and his entire family were baptized without delay. He brought them up into the house and set food before them. He and his entire household rejoiced that he had become a believer in God, the word of the Lord.
Thanks.
A reading from the Revelation to St. John the Evangelist. At the end of the visions, I, John, heard these words. See, I am coming soon. My reward is with me to repay according to everyone's work. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed are those who wash their robes so that they will have the right to the tree of life and may enter the city by the gates. It is I, Jesus, who sent my angel to you with this testimony for the churches. I am the root and the descendant of David, the bright morning star. The Spirit and the Bride say, "Come." And let everyone who knows, who hears, say, "Come." And let everyone who is thirsty come. Let anyone who wishes take the water of life as a gift. The one who testifies to these things says, "Surely I am coming soon." Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with all the saints. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus prayed for his disciples, and then he said, "I ask not only on behalf of these, but also on behalf of those who will believe in me through their word, that they may also be one. As you, Father, are in me, and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given them, so that they may be one as we are one. I in them, you in me, that they may be completely one. So that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I desire that those also whom you have given me may also be with me where I am to see my glory, which you have given me because you loved me before the foundation of the world. Righteous Father, the world does not know you, but I know you, and these know that you have sent me. I made your name known to them, and I will make it known to them, so that the love with which you have loved me may be in them, and I in them. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of Jesus, the Prince of Peace, in whom we live and move and have our being. Amen. Good morning, St. John's.
Good morning.
Good morning, those of you who are in the sanctuary today and those of you who are watching via YouTube. With the events of the last 2 weeks in mind, let's take a closer look at John's Gospel on this seventh and final Sunday in Eastertide. If we were practicing gospel-based discipleship this morning, the words that jump out to me are these: that they all may be one, that they may be completely one, praise Jesus, as you and I are one. These are the words and phrases I wonder about this morning. A prayerful plea for unity, then and now. Composed around 80 to 90 of the Common Era, in a time of persecution and war, a time of persecution closely connected to the conflicts between synagogue authorities and the emerging Christian community to which John has written. What do you make of this prayer in a time like this? These days of increasing individualism, the detailed ways in which we define ourselves. Who am I? How do I identify? These turbulent days of relentless disunity within the body of Christ in matters of abortion, immigration reform, where literally tens of thousands are clamoring to enter our southern border. Parents and school boards arguing about what should be taught and read in our schools, politicians debating the interpretations of the events of January 6th, to name a few. And now, at this very moment, this searing question is once again before us. How do we ensure the safety of Black citizens, persons of color, and our children? Do we need more guns or less guns? Do we need more police or fewer police? My niece is a first grade teacher in another state. It's a church-going family. They have a 3-year-old daughter, a 4-year-old daughter. Their dad, my nephew, is posting, "Stop listening to the media," and is suggesting more guns will protect his wife in her first grade classroom and their daughters. Jesus, John the Evangelist, when you pray, Jesus, that they all become one, completely one, does that mean we all have to get along all the time? Is it a call for constant agreement and accord? Is it a call for orthodoxy, right belief? Is it a call for control? Or is it about the nature of our being? Who I am, not who I, sorry, who am I, but who are we? I'm sorry, I'm getting mixed up. Not my being, but our being. Not I, but who are we with one another? One in Christ, whether we agree with each other or not. One in Christ, whether we like each other or not. Part of the community, part of one body. How do we understand Jesus' prayerful plea on the second anniversary of George Floyd's murder, right here in what Craig Lemming likes to say, right here in George Floyd City? Have our hearts been changed? How are we doing? Have we been converted to our book studies and webinars and confessions? Have they led to justice, to good trouble, and acts of repair? Thank you, Jay, for mentioning Tikkun Olam in your sermon last week. Tikkun Olam, the mending of the world, an essential tenet of Judaism, implies that while the world is innately good, its creator purposely left room for us to improve upon the creator's work. How are we doing? Tomorrow, Memorial Day, we remember these men and women who gave their lives to defend and protect democracy. It's the unofficial start of the Minnesota summer, the Bold North's Sabbath. We have 90 days to warm up, right? To plant those tomatoes, to teach the kids to swim and to fish, to make s'mores, and to wear sandals, which I noticed some of you wearing this morning. This year, Memorial Day weekend feels different. One short week ago, before we celebrated the Eucharist, we said the names of those black bodies murdered by an 18-year-old white supremacist with an assault rifle in Western New York, Buffalo, New York, the home of Niagara Falls. And today, we will say the names of 19 fourth graders and two teachers from a small Latino American city in West Texas, massacred. You know what? I looked up the word massacre to remind me what it really fully means. It means deliberately and violently killing a large number of people. Today, we remember those who were massacred by a deeply scarred, bullied high school dropout with few friends, who purchased an assault rifle for his 18th birthday. You know the story. Co-workers at Wendy's, where he worked for a while, and others ignored him. They ignored his threatening behaviors. They thought he was joking. Shaking his head in disbelief at the death toll, Pastor Jimenez rushed to the hospital to console two parishioners who'd lost their 10-year-old granddaughter. And he told the reporter afterwards that sometimes it's about my presence and prayers, but in times like this, all you can do is cry. Eternal Spirit, Earth maker, pain bearer, life giver, help me, I pray. We, your people, God's beloved, need words of hope to sustain us now. We are brokenhearted. Where is hope in this time of despair and national grief, this time of societal stuckness and regression, which is a common response to ongoing trauma and fear? Shall we pray the Psalms of Lament? Some churches are doing that this morning. Psalms like Psalm 13, how long, O Lord, how long must I wrestle with my thoughts and every day have sorrow in my heart? Or is it time not only for soothing, for the comfortable words of Scripture, like, let not your hearts be troubled. But is it time to heed the warnings of the prophets? Prophets like Isaiah, who thundered against those who built and maintained and sacrificed at the altars of false gods, false idols. Hear, O heavens, proclaims Isaiah, the word of the Lord. Hear, O heavens, and listen, O earth, for the Lord has spoken. When you stretch out your hands, I will hide my eyes, saith the Lord. I'll hide my eyes from you, because even though you make many prayers, I will not listen. Your hands are full of blood. You may know that our beloved bishop, Bishop Loya, is the father of a first grade boy and a fifth grade girl at Breck School. Here's what he posted this week. My soul is utterly crushed by the news out of Texas today. It's just too much to bear, and all I can do is join so many in weeping and crying out to the heavens. The only words I can find are shame. Shame on us, America. We've turned guns into an idol, and we've made it clear that we're willing to continue worshiping that idol at literally any cost. Though there is a clear way to reduce or eliminate the never-ending death toll from gun violence, dozens of countries have done it, and we've simply refused. Shame on us, America. Jenny told me just before we began that it took Jared 12 minutes to read all of those places of gun violence in America. 12 minutes. You know what? You'd think we were talking about the cartels, right? No, we're not talking about the cartels. Have you ever heard this definition of evangelism? It's one of my favorites. It's one beggar telling another beggar where to go to find food. One beggar telling another beggar where to go to find food. You know what? I'm one of those beggars today. I'm looking for food. I'm listening for the signals amidst the noise, wondering how we will summon the moral will and the courage in this individualistic society we live in and decide that we are going to work together to solve our immense challenges. I'm betting some of you know James Densley and Jillian Anderson, two academics, Minnesota professors, who run the Violence Project. Perhaps you've seen their posts or seen them in recent interviews. Their extensive research demonstrates that shooters often seek to, quote, cause as much death and destruction as possible so that a world that has otherwise ignored them would be forced to notice them and feel their anguish. Could we become one in noticing, listening, caring, taking seriously those who are profoundly wounded, lost, in anguish, and otherwise ignored? Could we do that? Seven years ago, 2016, I can't believe it was that long ago. Seems like it was yesterday, but you may know that Craig Lemming and Jared and Lisa Weens Heinzon from St. John the Baptist, myself and a few others, we founded Circle of the Beloved. Circle of the Beloved is a branch of the Episcopal Service Corps, an intentional community for young adults who would live in the former rectory at St. Andrew's Episcopal Church in North Minneapolis. Some of you came to rehab Liberty House. That was a big job. Some of you came and helped. And some of you invested funds in Circle so that young adults like Kat Lewis, who is broadcasting this sermon right now, young adults like Kat Lewis could have the opportunity to be supported and equipped to understand their God-given gifts, to increase among themselves, and to increase among folks like you and me, kinship across lines of difference. That's Circle's mission statement. Kinship across lines of difference. Well, where did that phrase come from? Did we make it up? No, we didn't make it up. Where did it come from? It largely came from learning and being inspired by the work of Greg Boyle. Greg Boyle is a Jesuit priest who founded and for the last 40 years has directed Homeboy Industries, the most successful gang intervention program in the United States, in Los Angeles, the gang capital of the world. So, as a beggar looking for food, I pulled his first book, Tattoos on the Heart, off my shelf this week to remind me of the stories that he tells about building kinship with young men society has ignored and would sooner have dead or locked up for life. Today, Homeboy Industries is a place of resurrection, a place of jobs, education, tattoo removal, purpose, dignity, and literally life. Let me just tell you a little bit about how it began. It began when Dolores Mission, the poorest parish in the Los Angeles Archdiocese, decided to practice the power of boundless compassion amongst young men. Young men, our society has labeled a lost cause, beyond redemption, better off dead. They decided not to ignore them, but to figure out how to build kinship among them. Kinship, Father Boyle has learned, is not serving the other, but being one with the other. Jesus was not a man for others, he reminds us. He was one with them, and there's a world of difference. Only kinship, inching ourselves closer to creating a community such that God might recognize it. Soon we imagine with God this circle of compassion. And then we imagine no one standing outside that circle, moving ourselves closer to the margins, so that the margins themselves will be erased. We stand there, writes Father Boyle, we stand there with those whose dignity has been denied. We locate ourselves with the poor and the powerless and the voiceless. At the edges, we join the easily despised and the readily left out. We stand with the demonized. Why? We stand with the demonized so that the demonizing will stop. And we situate ourselves right next to the disposable so that the day will come when we stop throwing people away. Stop, that's my words now, stop throwing away the otherwise ignored who are looking for a way to be heard. That's where I'm finding food today. Hope, a crack in a very complex world, a pathway in the midst of all of the complexities that we are facing. When you and I pray, Lord, make us instruments of your peace, we are one. When we nod in agreement in baptism liturgies, when we hear candidates or parents or godparents renouncing the evil doers of this world which corrupt and destroy the creatures of God, we're one. When we promise to do all in our power to support the baptized, very, very often young children, not always, but very, very often. When we promise to do all in our power to support the baptized, we are one. So in this culture, where, I don't know about you, but I hear fairly frequently, I can't be friends with so-and-so. Look what they just posted on Facebook. I can't be friends with so-and-so. Look what they just voted for. Look what they just said. Look what my nephew just said. I can't be friends with them anymore. Could we be one in practicing and promoting kinship, figuring out how to practice and promote kinship across lines of difference, keeping our hearts open to those who are disconnected, wounded by life, and yearning to be heard. Increasing among us, not just the individualism that is separating us, but kinship. Kinship across lines of difference that connects us. Could we learn to do that? Could we be one in the mending and repair of the world? In tikkun olam, the mending and repair of the world. In the name of Jesus, I pray with you this morning. In the name of Jesus, who prayed that we become one, completely one.